Inés de Asbaje y Ramírez de Santillana has been Mexico's most iconic woman in literature since the 17th century. She would break barriers in history by changing the perspective of how women were looked upon by becoming an illustrious intruder of the status quo. It was the mid-1600s in La Nueva España, or the New Spain, during the time when the Catholic Church had absolute control over moral conduct and behavior of its people. Anyone not abiding by the standards set by the church would have to face the Spanish Inquisition, which meant punishment by jail or even death. At the time, it was unheard of for a woman to be educated.
Some people just didn't think women could do it. They felt like women were too weak, both mentally and physically and emotionally, to engage in learning. Some men felt like if women engaged in learning, they would resist the role that they had been put into, which is exactly what you see with somebody like Sor Juana.
But the continued persistence and desires would eventually defy the church's norms. Her thoughts and writings would redefine her life as a nun, as a woman, and as a writer.
Ella, pues, está rompiendo barreras porque escribe, porque habla, porque lee, porque no tiene miedo a presentarse con todo su conocimiento, con todo su bagaje. Y pues no le queda de otra más que convertirse en monja, ¿no?
Juana Inés was born on November 12, 1648 in San Miguel Nepantla, Mexico. She learned to read at the age of 3 and spent countless hours in her grandfather's library. Her passion to learn included endless begging to her mother for permission to attend a local university. Juana was willing to disguise herself as a man, but her mother rejected the idea. At age 11, she was sent to Mexico City to live with her aunt, where she had the opportunity to study under a scholarly priest. In 1664, she was appointed to the court of the viceroy Antonio Sebastián de Toledo, but members of the court and church were not happy that a woman was part of the elite circle of intellectuals. The viceroy sponsored a public exam to test and justify her advanced intelligence. He invited 40 scholars, including mathematicians, historians, and poets, to test the 17-year-old girl. Amazed by her answers and her intelligence, she was presented to the court, where she was given the position of lady-in-waiting and tutor to the viceroy's wife. Her beauty and intelligence attracted many suitors, and she was expected to marry just like every other woman in society at the time. Challenging the status quo meant giving up her role as a wife and as a mother to become a nun and continue her education.
She decided that she wanted to be a scholar, she wanted to be an academic. It had been an interest of her whole life. She was a scholarly child. And so she knew, though, that if she were to marry and have children, the expectations would be that she would then focus her whole life on her husband and not her children. And so becoming a nun at that time was a way to escape that.
At the age of 21, she left the court and entered the convent of the Order of Saint Jerome, where she became a nun and took the name of Sor Juana Inés de la Cruz. Her friendship with the viceregal couple granted her all sorts of privileges. She had her own kitchen, a servant, and a private library. It contained more than 4,000 volumes and was one of the largest private libraries in the New World. Throughout her life at the convent, she wrote many poems, plays, and religious songs called villancicos. Many of her works were published and widely read in Spain. She was skilled in the arts and music, but also studied philosophy and natural science. She even took the role of being the accountant of the convent for 9 years and the main cook. The first record of a recipe book ever made in viceregal Mexico was written by Sor Juana. Sor Juana's most famous poem is Hombres Necios, or Foolish Men. In this piece, she accuses men of being unreasonable for criticizing women for their courage and intellect.
Como el de hombres necios que acusáis a la mujer sin razón. Es un mensaje lleno de claridad, diciendo cómo es la estructura patriarcal. Fíjense, desde entonces sabemos las mujeres qué es lo que está sucediendo en torno a esa mentalidad que quiere mantener a las mujeres al servicio del hombre, ¿no? O a servicio de un sistema que solamente le va a servir a las hegemonías y se va replicando y sirve para que continuemos sufriendo y para que alguien tenga la voz de mando todo el tiempo, ¿no? Un solo grupo, un solo personaje, en este caso con los hombres.
In 1690, Sor Juana wrote a critique of a famous sermon by a Portuguese Jesuit preacher. The Bishop of Puebla was outraged and responded by publishing her critique and denouncing her for creating ideas in women which were not pleasing to God. He urged Sor Juana to shift her focus to religious studies and leave worldly studies to men. Sor Juana responded with her famous letter named Respuesta, or Response, where she speaks out for her desire to learn and defends women's rights to education.
The way she was addressing issues of a woman's role in society, that's been her most long-lasting impact. And her sort of logical arguments about how women are treated and how the double standard that women often face. So she points out in both her poetry and her writings, her famous letter, that women are almost set up to fail.
La Respuesta has been said to be the first feminist manifesto ever created in the New World. The clergy became infuriated by her literary work, and the Archbishop demanded that she give up all non-religious books and end all her studies. On her 25th anniversary as a nun, Juana signed a document stating that she planned to donate all her books, maps, and instruments to raise money to help the poor. She devoted herself to a rigorous penance by completely giving up her studies and writings. In 1694, Mexico City suffered from the most devastating outbreaks of the plague, affecting Sor Juana's convent of St. Jerome. She helped nurse her fellow sisters until becoming infected herself, unable to survive. Sor Juana Inés de la Cruz died on April 17, 1694, at the age of 44.
You have to just have these voices throughout history. Sor Juana was one of the voices saying, this doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense that one half of the population is kept in bondage to the other half of the population. It doesn't make sense in so many ways because it doesn't allow women to achieve their full personhood. And that was a question in Sor Juana's time, and it's still a question today.
Sor Juana is celebrated and considered a national icon in Mexico and is known throughout the world for talents in literature. Her convent became a prestigious university bearing her name, and her image is seen every day around Mexico in currency bills. Sor Juana left an impact not only in local culture, but globally influenced and redefined how women should challenge the status quo. The status quo that at the time largely oppressed and set a prejudice against women, portraying females as inferior to males. She became prominent in the late 20th century by influencing the rise of feminism and women's writings, officially being credited as the first published feminist of the New World and most outstanding writer of the Spanish-American colonial period. Sor Juana Inés de la Cruz left an impact in society by doing what she loved most, but most importantly, allowed for a future generation of women to pursue their dreams regardless of gender or race. Her impact, her influence, and the change she made hundreds of years ago continue to set a path for women around the world to break barriers today.